Today, the majority of our energy comes from fossil fuels we find beneath the earth in the form of coal, natural gas, and oil. We've seen a rise in renewable energy, but fossil fuels are still the main source, and without them, the economy would collapse. But these are going to become harder and harder to find and extract in an efficient way, which is why alternative forms of energy are going to take over. Solar is one alternative that is becoming more and more popular. Although it is more expensive to get power from solar energy currently, the cost of fossil fuels is going to rise and the cost of solar is falling. Once equilibrium is met, market forces will do the rest. And note that solar cells are actually not that efficient, so two engineering options are to make them more efficient or reduce the cost to make and install these in bulk. And these are two directions that research has gone. Wind is another popular form of energy, but it will not be what supplies the bulk of energy for the world in the future. I mean, it can only work when the wind blows, and they can only generate so much during this time. But there's a form of energy that doesn't supply any of our electricity or power right now, because science is not there yet, but if we figure it out, it could solve all energy problems, and that is nuclear fusion. And this is hopefully what the future holds. Fusion is what the sun uses to create energy. But first, let's make a very important distinction. We have nuclear power plants right now, and when you hear about these and nuclear energy, this is usually all in reference to nuclear fission. This is where uranium atoms are split, and when they're split, they create a lot of energy that we can use and send out to homes and businesses. And this is good because when you do that, you don't create greenhouse gases, which is good for the environment, of course. So why don't we just have nuclear power plants? Well, one big thing is they leave behind a lot of nuclear waste. A typical reactor can create 30 tons of nuclear waste a year that can remain radioactive for millions of years. This is so dangerous that we have to keep them in special cooling ponds. This makes nuclear power plant meltdowns also catastrophic, and there have been some in the past, such as Three Mile Island or Chernobyl. Nuclear fusion is different though. It's about fusing two atoms instead of splitting one, and these are normally hydrogen atoms, where the two things you see on the left are just isotopes of hydrogen, and this releases a lot of energy. This is also much safer than fission, but achieving this is not easy to do. Imagine this. You have two cars, each with very strong magnets on them that have the same magnetic pole, so they repel each other. But there's some latch where if you do manage to get the cars close, the latch holds them together so powerfully that they don't come apart. This is one big obstacle of fusion. Hydrogen atoms repel each other a lot until they get extremely close, hence why the sun is able to create nuclear fusion. The gravity is so intense, but here on Earth it's a different story. But again, when you do fuse two atoms, it releases a ton of energy. In fact, fusion releases 10 million times more energy than gasoline pound for pound. An 8-ounce glass of water contains the energy of 500,000 barrels of petroleum that we could potentially harness. The issue with fusion power is it's hard to do though. No one has created an operating fusion power plant, and scientists all over the world are trying to unlock this potential energy source. In the US, there's the National Ignition Facility, where they have over 100 giant laser beams that fire down a tunnel and focus on a small pellet, sending it to around 100 million degrees, which releases the power of fusion. In France, at the International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor, they create a thin ring of plasma that is trapped due to a magnetic field, then they heat it using several methods, which starts to cause the plasma protons to start fusing. There are many other experiments out there at big labs, and if you're looking to go into a field like physics, this is something you could potentially do. Now, one last thing about fusion is that we've done it. In fact, someone did it at 14 years old, and it can be done for around $3,000 just getting the right equipment. So why isn't it powering your home right now? Because these experiments have all been net negative. It took more energy to fuse the atoms than was released. I mean, big experiments are using things like giant lasers, and those take a lot of power, and the fusing of atoms needs to create more. This might not come up for another few decades, but considering this method of energy will be safe, produce more energy than any other source, be cheap, and not harm the environment, people are hopeful for it to become reality for us soon. Now let's move on to superconductors. If you ever thought about having a car that can hover above the ground and travel well over 100 miles an hour while using minimum fuel, this might be our best bet. Just remember that most of the fuel in your car is used to overcome the force of friction on the road. If the road was perfectly smooth ice and you could get up to speed, you could just cruise to your destination. That is assuming the path was completely straight though. But you get the idea, and this is where superconductors come in. Over 100 years ago, we found out that mercury loses all electrical resistance, aka becomes a superconductor, when cooled to just 4 degrees above absolute zero, or 4 Kelvin. This means electrons can move around freely with no friction, unlike in your electronics that get hot due to that friction. High-temperature superconductors have also been discovered since then, but quote, high temperature means like 138 Kelvin or minus 135 degrees Celsius. So a problem with just getting and keeping a material as a superconductor is we would need to have a serious cooling system to maintain those temperatures. This is why scientists are looking into room temperature superconductors that would change the world, but currently they do not exist, although we can easily see what they will do. For example, when it comes to transmission lines that deliver power to our homes, up to 30% of electricity generated is wasted due to friction in the wires, which also means electrical power plants need to be closer to our homes, thus increasing the danger of nuclear power plants. But with superconductors, those losses disappear, and our electric bill goes down significantly. Room temperature superconductors would also be capable of producing super magnets that can lift cars or even trains above the ground, and this is due to how magnetic field lines bunch up since they cannot penetrate a superconductor. This creates a cushion that can hold up the object. In the future, we might have roads made of superconductors allowing cars and trains to hover above the ground with such little friction that even a breeze could get them started. There currently are magnetic levitation trains that use magnets to hover, but the economics of these have prevented them from being adopted all around the world, and superconductors might change all of this. Last century was considered the age of electricity that made new technology possible. Superconductors may soon open up the age of magnetism. Also, when it comes to energy, one thing they're considering is space-based solar power, where hundreds of satellites in orbit would absorb radiation from the sun at almost all hours of the day and then send it down to Earth. But the trouble with this is it would be very expensive, prices then need to go down, which brings us to the future of space travel. Here's a rocket. This is a SpaceX rocket I randomly chose to show, but when it comes to rockets in general, typically by mass they are like 80% fuel, 16% actual rocket, and the rest is the payload, which goes right here in the top. This payload might be a satellite going into space that will provide safe government communications, or it could be supplies for astronauts at the International Space Station. It's normally the purpose of the launch, so yes, the actual cargo of the rocket is a very small part of it volume-wise. So why are rockets so big? Well, because they need to hold a lot of fuel. And why is this? Because the rockets have to go fast. Remember, going into orbit is not expensive because of how high you have to go, it's because of the speed the rocket needs to get to. Planes can already go fairly high, but they go 600 miles per hour or 965 kilometers per hour. Rockets need to go like 18,000 miles per hour or about 29,000 kilometers per hour to actually reach orbit, and that costs more money. Now, for most of history, rockets were launched into space and their multiple stages were burned up or landed in the ocean and never used again. And this is one reason why it costs around $10,000 on average to send a pound into space. One thing being worked on to change this is reusable rockets. If it costs $100 million for a company to build a rocket, then some company wants to put their satellite in orbit, it'll cost them more than $100 million in order for a profit to be made. But if the rocket can be launched 10 times or something, it could cost $20 million per launch, and profit would still be made. SpaceX is one company you've probably heard of that's made these, where their first stage, or the lower part of the rocket, is detached during flight and comes back to Earth and lands standing up to be used again, thus saving them money from having to make a totally new one. Now this was oversimplified because the entire rocket is not reusable, only certain parts are, plus you gotta refurbish the used rocket as it just went into space, so it's not like it's all good to go back immediately. It needs to be fixed up a bit. But there are other methods being looked at or that have been tried to get things to space cheaply. You could try launching the rocket from higher up, using powerful lasers to propel the rocket, and one very famous idea is the space elevator. At a certain height above Earth, objects in orbit will be in geostationary orbit, which means they orbit at the same rotational speed that the Earth is spinning at. This means objects in that orbit are always above the exact same location on Earth. So imagine having something in orbit like that, and you attach a really long cable from that object to Earth and tie the cable so it's fixed. Or just imagine those white and red lines are just long cables. Then it would all rotate together. Now to put something in orbit, it would literally just need to go up the cable like an elevator. From basic math or physics, we know the actual speed something in rotation is moving at is the radius of its motion times the angular velocity, or basically a multiple of rotations over time. Omega is always the same as Earth's angular speed and unchanging. But if you increase the radius or distance from the center of rotation by going up the elevator, you increase your velocity, which again is the thing you need to truly get to orbit, but this takes way less power. Now, engineers and scientists still need to figure out the material that would be used for such a cable. Plus, of course, there are many concerns with how long it would need to be, safety concerns, and more. But who knows what the future has in store when it comes to this. Cheaper access to space would mean more potential for a moon base as well as a base on Mars. Average people who aren't billionaires might be able to go to space in the future. Also, this would allow for asteroid mining. We're using equipment we could collect various elements that are found in asteroids, such as carbon, water, silicon, and metals like iron and nickel. These could have economic benefits here on Earth through selling these materials. However, it is assumed that these elements will likely be used to continue to settle space and increase how fast we explore the solar system. Now, there are of course so many more technologies that will be here in the future that I didn't talk about. Some include the driverless car, where you'll be able to drive a car while at the same time doing things like going on the internet through the use of your contact lenses or glasses. In nanotechnology, one of the big goals will be to put nanobots in our bloodstream that constantly patrol for diseases or abnormalities to keep us healthy. Another holy grail of this field is making nanobots that can assemble anything we need, where you basically put in raw material to a machine, and the nanobots can just make what you want by taking apart the raw material molecule by molecule. 3D printing is also a big field, where for example, General Electric is using it to produce parts that are more lightweight, thus saving millions of dollars. 3D printing may also get to a point where we all have a 3D printer, and people share files on the internet that you can download and just use to 3D print something you need. Entrepreneurs might make money off of making and selling these files that 3D print something unique and or useful for consumers. There will also be applications in printing organs to remove danger from transplants, and plenty more. To make this video, I gathered information from various books such as Physics of the Future, Soonish, Rise of the Robots, and a few more, which all give so much more detail on all these fields that I just couldn't get into. I'll provide a link below to the Major Prep Amazon store where you can find all those books, plus some more of my favorites if you're interested in buying and supporting the channel. And lastly, before I go, one reason for this video was people asking me what fields of science or engineering will and won't be around in the future. And it's safe to say that not many people know what will happen. We can only make predictions. I mean, petroleum engineering will probably go down significantly as alternative energy becomes cheaper, but right now petroleum jobs are increasing, it looks like. Space travel will not go away, and with it getting cheaper, maybe that'll open up more opportunities for aerospace engineers. It seems safe to say that computer engineers, software engineers, and computer scientists have a safe future for now, considering how much is going into software, programming, data storage, artificial intelligence, and so on. Physicists and even materials engineers might get more job opportunities as funding for superconductors is increased, considering it will have a huge impact on the economy. If nuclear fusion becomes a thing, we'll still need electrical engineers to handle all that electricity, distribute it, and plenty of other scientists and engineers to maintain the plants. You can see how some industries could die, but others will be born. It's more important that you stay knowledgeable on future technologies and have a broad knowledge of them, while also a deep level of knowledge in your field. This way you can prepare for any changes and not be blindsided by big shifts in the industry. For those going to college soon, it's unlikely any big field, especially of engineering or science, will die in the next few years. In fact, according to the statistics, most engineering fields are growing. Yes, some don't have nearly as much job opportunities as others, so make sure to do your own research on that. I can only tell you so much, but hopefully this is a start. And I'm going to end that video here. Again, links are below, and if you like the video, don't forget to comment, like, and subscribe, and I'll see you all next time.